There's a perfectly natural tendency on the part of most people to pattern their lives after the lives of those by whom they're habitually surrounded. Lacking the kind of leadership they could have, they passively mold themselves, for the most part, into their existing environment. In an early direct line, we talked about the dilemma faced by most human beings in our kind of society, which is the matter of making decisions. We've learned that ours is the only species on Earth whose natural state is one of disorientation, and therefore each of us must create his own world, even if the creation of our world consists of nothing more than playing copycat, closing our eyes and ears and just blindly following the person in front of us, hoping that somehow he or the person he's following knows where he's going and that when we get there, we'll both like it. We like to think that we're intelligent and perhaps even bold decision makers, but the facts seem to indicate that we're not, and that we use all kinds of dodges to keep from making decisions. In reading a back issue of Psychology Today, April 1973, I learned of a book which I immediately ordered, written by Princeton philosopher Walter Kaufman, entitled With Guilt and Justice, From Decidophobia to Autonomy. Now in this book, with a long title, obviously the result of many years of thoughtful study and research and a lot of independent thinking, Kaufman lists and explains 10 major cop-outs most of us use to keep from making decisions, and which makes us decidophobes. Decidophobia is simply the fear of making decisions. He lists as the most common form of this malady, which robs us of our freedom and opportunity, plain everyday drifting. We go through the motions day after day. We get up, get dressed, go to work, on the job and off. We simply let the tide take us as it has in the past. Kaufman calls that type A drifting. Type B drifting is a fooler. It's the kind of drifting people do who pretend they don't belong to type A. He, the type B drifter, tries to give the impression that he is in revolt against the so-called status quo that he sees about him on every side, and he drops out of life. He lives from moment to moment, day to day, letting chance decide the direction of his life. Now, this is simply another form of drifting, another cop-out, another way of avoiding the agony of making meaningful, faithful decisions. This type conforms as rigidly to his group of failures, in his dress or lack of it, his hair, his walk, his talk, his attitude, as the type A drifter conforms to his. The whole thing is a studied and thus tense acting job, all for the sake of avoiding decisions and taking charge of one's own life. He goes on to point out that religion has for centuries been mankind's number one strategy for avoiding decision. We don't even have to decide which of the many religions and sects to choose. Our parents usually make the choice for us, just as their parents made the choice for them. We are confirmed in that faith at an early age, long before we have anything even approaching the powers of intelligent choice, and we simply grow up in it. Now we have all the shall-nots and shalls we need, and every week we have an official of our faith to tell us what we should be doing and how we should be living our lives. Now this is not always the case, of course. Many people have chosen their own religions for important reasons and have found meaning and satisfaction in doing so. But the great multitude simply moves up another notch on the generation bracket, just as it does with its political party and other prejudices. After religion comes the type A and type B drifters that I mentioned. Incidentally, it seems that in order to be a drifter, many people require a regular supply of alcohol, drugs, or tranquilizers to keep their minds below the threshold of the window through which they might get a clear view of themselves and their meaningless lives. Kaufman refers to these people as being inauthentic. And it seems that when just plain drifting brings about a feeling of hopelessness, this type will join a movement of some kind. When a person lacks identity within himself, he will often strive to find it in an organization of some sort which will take over the decision-making role. What we're seeking, as Professor Kaufman of Princeton points out, is autonomy. Authenticity as sovereign persons. An autonomous person avoids all 10 strategies. He does not treat his own conclusions and decisions as authoritative or necessarily best, but chooses with his eyes open and then keeps them open, Kaufman says. He has the courage to admit that he may be wrong even about matters of the greatest importance. He objects to the 10 strategies in the book, not on account of their supposed psychological origins, but because they preclude uninhibited self-criticism. Now, there are some well-known people who've resisted all 10 strategies and lived autonomous lives. The most outstanding examples from the long history of Western philosophy are Socrates and Nietzsche. And Kaufman cites as a perfect modern example of the completely autonomous person, one who exhibits the most awesome courage, Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Rarely has it been so difficult for any man to stand alone, utterly alone, without any prop of any kind. His great books, The First Circle, Cancer Ward, Solzhenitsyn, a documentary record in August 1914, show how he succeeded in resisting all 10 temptations, making one fateful decision after another against seemingly insuperable odds. His life is autonomy in action. I have read Solzhenitsyn's books, and I consider them to be among the most important in my library, and I recommend them to you. How does one go about making decisions on his own, decisions calculated to bring him face to face with the best possible life for him? He goes by his gut feelings. He listens to the voice within, and he knows Thoreau was right when he said, if one advances confidently in the direction of his dreams and endeavors to live the life which he has imagined, he will meet with a success unexpected in common hours. It's the decision to live my life, not necessarily the lives of those I see about me. In Man and People, Ortega says that each one of us is always in danger of not being the unique and untransferable self which he is. The majority of men, he wrote, perpetually betray this self which is waiting to be. And to tell the whole truth, our personal individuality as a personage which is never completely realized, a stimulating utopia, a secret legend which each of us guards in the depths of his heart. It is thoroughly comprehensible that Pindar summarizes his heroic ethics in the well-known imperative, become what you are. Become what you are. That perhaps sums it up best, and this kind of thinking runs counter to the kindergarten philosophy of most people that the purpose of life is to be happy. Happiness is to life what a paint job is to a product. It's the glistening veneer and nothing more. What counts is the product itself, its quality, the depth, the truth of its design and purpose. My good friend Norman Guest of the Dartnell Company reminded me of a quotation from Alex Munth's novel, The Story of San Michel. It was published back in 1929 and was the book that started the vogue and success of the many doctor books, movies, soap operas, and television programs since. But in it, there appears this line. A man can stand a lot as long as he can stand himself. He can live without hope, without books, without friends, without music, as long as he can listen to his own thoughts. As long as he can listen to his own thoughts. And it's on those thoughts that we should act. There is often pain in that. The birth pains of new birth, and perhaps an occasional sensation of falling, of being unsupported. It means not sitting and wallowing in our old beliefs, but moving out of them into new, fresh territory. It means asking the question, am I living by my standards, or by the standards of those about me? And are they living by their own standards or the standards of those about them? It's possible that we've all been wrong. Soren Kierkegaard wrote, the greatest danger, that of losing one's own self, may pass off quietly as if it were nothing. Every other loss, that of an arm, a leg, $5, and so forth, is sure to be noticed. That was written more than 100 years ago. The key word in our thinking, in our conduct, in our goals, and in our lives is authenticity. We need to become what we are. How many times have you heard a woman say, well, it's what they're wearing this year, which is another way of saying, this is the current uniform, or whatever they wear, I will wear, and men are just as bad. If the style is drooping Jesse James gunfighter-type mustaches, you'll see them adorning male upper lips from Maine to California. You'll see them in your rear-view mirror of your car and all about you on the street. Whatever starts out as something new and different immediately becomes the commonplace. The desire to copy others is so deeply ingrained in the human organism as to be a constant source of amazement. Until you remember the wise words of our friend José Ortega y Gasset. It is the natural state of man to find himself disoriented in his world. He is seeking orientation, a path to follow. And if others seem to know what they're doing or where they're going, well, he'll quickly get in line. Few people in our society are sufficiently mature, sufficiently wise, to go their own way regardless of the ebb and flow of fads and fashions. Few women have the kind of inner composure and are sure enough of what they like to pick their wardrobes from their own likes and dislikes and wear them, not in spite of the crowd, but in the simple, independent desire to wear those clothes that most please them. It isn't a matter of men or women, it's a matter of human beings who've never developed a way of their own in the world. It isn't that the independent, free person wants to be an iconoclast and stand out as a character in the crowd, just the opposite. He doesn't care if he stands out or not. He doesn't need to stand out. He's content with his evolving self. He's growing. He hopes to get better, but he's satisfied with his progress. It's perfectly natural that the person who lacks inner direction will seek to find direction in a group of some kind. This is not to say we should not belong to organizations, only that we should try to find out what is important to us and go our own way. Or perhaps I should say, grow our own way.